Pastor Gavin, Assistant Pastor Smith, Associate Ministers, my mother's board, and Second Baptist Church, my family. I just want to thank you for this opportunity. When my mother asked me to do this, I said, I got a poem. I think I might have an old poem. But then something came over me. This poem came out almost at once. And then I started to understand what my daddy meant when he would say, I don't know about this sermon. People might get mad at me. But I said, Thomas, I don't know if I should do this. When he said, is it true? I said, yes. He said, is the church a place for truth? I said, yes. He said, well, then say the poem.
All right, yeah.
I hear from Howard University, HU.
Yeah, yeah.
I want to thank Second Baptist for donating money to the high school students to go on the Black College Tour. I didn't get an opportunity to thank you for that. I have to say a couple things about this poem. When you hear me say the devil, I'm not talking about the white man. I'm talking about evil. The devil is the devil, and the devil thrives on hate. The devil thrives on fear. The devil thrives on lies, and the devil thrives on love of money. Not money, but the love of money to the point where you will lie to yourself. Okay, so I want to make that clear. And we're all related through the blood of Jesus Christ. And so when I talk about our kin, I'm talking about humanity. Our schools are under attack. There was actually a state consultant who recommended to Benton Harbor area schools to close their Black History class this year. And the class was closed, and we had to fight to get it back open. So I want you to understand that this is real, and I appreciate Second Baptist for addressing education as a part of our Black History Month. I think it's very forward thinking. The name of this poem is entitled The State Test. I was placed in this category called Black. So in place of my bedtime stories, this checkbox checked out horror stories called Alternative Facts. Then I was chased by an allegory called Tracks. 5% closeout clearance. Black schools for sale. Disrupt their learning time and watch Black students dig their own heels. Couldn't seem to get this stigma off my back. Clueless. Track my progress and reveal that I was less. But what they refused to review was the validity of their racially biased tests. They hastily buried the ancient intellectual contributions of my people so that my belief in me was laid to rest at their feet. You see, my progress was never their purpose. This mind game was a PR ploy to trick our little boys into believing that their brainwaves was nothing more than hostile noise. And clearly, she was amazing. But by then, fear claimed it was too late. His esteem was in the grave, and her belief was beyond saving. See, they refused to pick up the other books until their daily readings were lying in a cart for inmates. And you know what happens next to society's released jailbaits after their outdates. Felons are the perfect folklores for poverty and pointing fingers, closed doors to opportunities, state properties. The only answer to this revolving door is love, unity, second chances, and legislative changes in Lansing. Listen, gifts from the devil come with a price. It's time to buy back your Black life. Black women, Black men, get your own everything, and I mean everything. Forget what's trending. Your own linens, your own tests. Get your own businesses. Cadet your own officers. Vet your own judges. Voir dire your jurors. Green thumb your own cures. Parents and children, take control of your schools. Take charge of your fountains and bottle your own water to finance your own pools. You think you're driving, but not as long as corporate got five on your fuel. He's paying for your silence, man, but I don't blame you. You think I'm tripping? Break rank. His henchmen can't wait to pull your licenses. Your intentions may be cool, but here's a clue from blue suit, red tie. You're nothing more than his handy dandy tool. His smile shines in your pupils, but those teeth in your eyes are headlights in disguise. Plotting to run you over, my dear friend, my co-worker, my lover. Know the enemy ain't your kin. Know yourself and take cover in the truth. For the truth is the only mother set for freedom. The only state test that matters is your state of mind. Your faith to lead men's best to a purpose-driven life. The love you choose to give and the God that you invite. See, I don't care about your statuses and I ain't moved by your degrees. My test has just two questions, kids. How many have you helped? And does your act match who you be?
All right.
Oh, I believe. type of singing that I shall attempt to do.
Oh, yes, sir.
Sort of done it at home in the shower and never before a congregation. But I'll do my best. Sister Stewart called me and wondered if I could possibly do something like this. I'm well familiar with it. I grew up in an area where it's quite prevalent. And I thoroughly enjoyed being in congregations when this type of singing took place.
Yes.
I know Reverend Smith, you got my back. Sister Blake. I know some of you know all about this type of singing. Sister McCree. Lining a hymn is a common art from a form that has been practiced for centuries. The basic style is that a leader, usually a deacon, raises the song by reciting a lyric and the congregation carols the line back. This is done a cappella and follows a distinct medley melody. It has been known by many names: lining out, raising a hymn, long meter, or Dr. White. And I've also heard it referred to as call and response. The singing style originated in England as a way of compensating for the lack of hymnals and facilitating participation for illiterate parishioners. It eventually made its way to this country during slavery. Lining a hymn accompanied blacks' conversions to Christianity and flourished because of their forced illiteracy. There's a speculation that the oral tradition of many West African cultures made the practice particularly appealing to black slaves pressed into servitude. As with the more familiar Negro spirituals, the lyrics of lined out hymns centered on enduring suffering with strength, believing that an end to the grief will one day come. As such, in the black church, the purpose of lining out a hymn always has been more than a practice based on the availability of songbooks. It serves as a choral binding of the congregation, one to another, expressed in the harmonies of a shared sorrows and the strength drawn from being on one musical accord. After the end of slavery, this custom slowly began to fade. The spread of literacy among blacks, the large migration north in search of economic opportunity, and the advent of gospel music, popularity has mostly relegated lining out to that of an ancient art when it's heard in contemporary black churches. It's often historic commemoration. It still, however, lives on in rural corners of the country where the centuries-old pain of the Black American experience hangs in the air and saturates the soul. So what I shall attempt to do, I love the Lord. You heard my cry. And then you respond where you should respond. I love the Lord. He heard my cry.
All of God's people. Yeah. is truly a blessing to be living another day where we can give all the glory, all the honor and praises to our Heavenly Father. He has been so good. So good.
So good.
Those of you who have your Bibles, I would like for you to stand and travel with me to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5, verses 14 through 16. Matthew chapter 5, verses 14 through 16. When you have arrived there, say amen.
Amen.
The word of God reads, "Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick. And it giveth light to all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven." You may be seated. Today I would like to use as a subject, let your light shine. Turn to your neighbor and just tell your neighbor, let their light shine. Turn to your other neighbor and tell them, let your light shine. A man one day was at an airport standing in line for nearly an hour. So he thought he'd go up and see what was going on because the line was not moving. He got to a baggage handler and he said, "Nothing is going on. Is there a problem?" And the guy said, "Yeah, we have a big problem. Our power is down and nothing is working. The computers aren't working. The conveyor belts are not working. Nothing is working and we are waiting for things to get better." So the man waited. And he waited and he waited hour after hour after hour. Uh-huh. No planes could come in, no planes could go out. And he found himself stuck in an uncomfortable situation because he was trapped. Mm-hmm. He couldn't get to where he wanted to go because things weren't working. Finally, across the loudspeaker, the announcement was made, "I'm sorry, ladies and gentlemen, the airport is now closed." He found himself caught in a blackout because of a power grid failure in Canada that worked itself down the East Coast. So he thought things were going to get better, but they got worse because not only could he not catch a plane, he had already checked out of his hotel. So things were worse off than he thought. What is he going to do? Thousands of people are just scared out of their minds. So he called back home and he told his assistant, "We have a major problem. The airport is closed. There's no power. Things aren't working. And I don't have a place to reside tonight. Can you do me a favor and just call my travel agent and see if you can find me a place?" So she called back in about 5 or 10 minutes and she said, "The Crown Plaza has one room left, but they can only hold it for 10 minutes because so many people are trying to get rooms." So he hailed down a taxi and it's beginning to get dark now. So he jumped in a cab and he made his way down to the hotel. And he walks in a candlelit hotel because there's no power, so there are no lights. He had to register by hand. because the computers were not working. He had to use a flashlight to get to his rooms because there was no power. So he walked into the room with a flashlight, and all he could do was hope that tomorrow would be a better day. Wow. It was the middle of August, so it was hot outside. The air conditioner wasn't working. So he decided, let me just open up the curtain so I can open up the window. And that's when he saw it. Across the street was a Marriott hotel, completely lit up. Yeah. I mean, it was lit up. Yeah. He opened the window and there was music playing. There was people hanging out and eating and stuff. So inquiring minds want to know what's going on.
All right.
He's trying to figure out how in the world, how can there be so much light in the midst of so much darkness? Yeah. So he makes his way down across the street and things are just lit up. Mm-hmm. He got to the lobby of the hotel and the lobby was lined up full of televisions. CNN is discussing how dark New York is. People were standing in line getting their food, something his hotel didn't have. So he says to himself, I need to find an assistant manager and find out what is going on. Because this is just, it's a blackout everywhere except for this hotel. So he goes up to the assistant manager and he says, I need you to explain something to me. No light anywhere, no lights on the street. Houses don't even have lights unless they have a flashlight or candles or something. How can this be? And the assistant manager said, you know what? People have been asking that question all day long, and it's really very simple. He said, when this hotel was built, it was built with a gas generator. So we have power on the inside that's not determined by circumstances on the outside. Even though the circumstances are not working in our favor, we got something working on our behalf that overrides what everybody else is experiencing in a dark situation. I'm sure you can agree with me that our world is in a dark situation. Whether you're living overseas, living in California, living in New York, Chicago, Illinois, or Benton Harbor, Michigan, there's enough darkness to go around. Verse 14 says, ye are the light of the world. If we live for Christ, we will glow like lights. But you know, some folks allow their circumstances to dim their light. We dim our light by being quiet when we should speak up. We dim our light when we decide to go along with the crowd so we can fit in. We dim our light by not explaining our light to others. We dim our light by ignoring the needs of others. We dim our light by letting sin dim our light. Many Christians today are hidden from sight. Many are reluctant to be identified as Christians. Such a Christian is like a brand new light that never leaves the carton it came in. If a lamp doesn't help people to see, it isn't worth very much. So I ask you this question. Does your life show other people how to find God? Does your life show people how to live for God? God expects everyone. He expects us. He expects us to let our light shine. I remember when I was a kid singing in the choir back here. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. We are expected to shine, not just here in church, but everywhere we go. But some folks allow situations situations to dim their light. Like when they get around certain people,
all right,
the light comes out. When they get around certain friends, the light goes out. When they get around certain family members, the light goes out. When they get to work and get into it with a coworker, the light goes out. Some of them get into it with their professor, the light goes out. Some students get into it with other students, and the light goes out. And we know the light goes out when you tell a person, I'm going to give you a piece of my mind. Look, don't you make me lose my religion. I'm going to have to put her in check. I'm going to have to check him. Come on, y'all know what I'm talking about. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Holy words are not coming out of your mouth at the time. So what are some things that are keeping you from shining? Is it complacency? Is it resentment? Is it fear? Is it embarrassment? Is it stubbornness? Is it disobedience? Is it peer pressure? Is it certain challenges that you aren't able to handle? You know, little did I know that I would face many challenges the summer of 1996 when I moved to Montgomery, Alabama to attend Alabama State University. When I got down there, I decided to get into marching band. You know, I'm thinking it would be a piece of cake. Boy, was I wrong. There were many things that new band members were not allowed to do. We couldn't walk across the grass. We couldn't use the elevators. It don't matter how much luggage you have, but you get on those elevators. We couldn't wear band paraphernalia. And a host of other things that I can't mention because this is about as long as your laundry list. And it was much like pledging a fraternity. You don't cross over until you perform on that last football game, which was known as the Turkey Day Classic. So it was many things that we couldn't do. And a lot of stuff, you know, I didn't mind, you know, walking across the grass and not taking the elevators. You know, I thought it was foolish, but, you know, I can go along with that. But I remember this particular moment when the section leader, he said to us, he said, you can't wear any hats. And by the way, all freshman males must shave off all their facial hair and all the hair off the top of your head. Now at the time, we were standing in formation, standing at attention with our instruments, eyes forward. But when he said, shave off all your hair, I broke formation. I peeked around for our band member, and I said, whoa, hold on, dog. You mean to tell me? Not only can we not wear hats, but we got to shave off all our hair. Now, look, because you know back then you can get your little fade, you know, sides get bald, but you got the fro at the top. None of that, all that had to go. Pretty much like I am now. So he said to me, he came over and he said, where you from, Crab? That's what they call new band members, they call us Crabs, because we wasn't a part of the band until we crossed over. So where you from, Crab? I said, I'm from Benton Harbor, Michigan. He said, walk to Montgomery, Alabama, drop down and give me 100 push-ups.
Oh my God.
Wow. If any of you have ever been to Alabama, you know it gets hot down there. At 5 a.m., it's already 80 degrees outside. It's hot. So we couldn't wear hats. We had to shave off all our hair. On the band field, there are no trees in sight. So that hot sun is beaming down on your bald head. You are literally melting. So all the freshman males in the band shaved off their hair. Now, I had a problem with that. And I asked the section leader, I said, what does shaving my head have to do with my musical abilities? What does that have to do with me knowing my position on the field? What does that have to do with me memorizing the 75 songs we must learn before the first football game? What does shaking my head have to do with me knowing the dance routine, showing up on practice on time. Help me understand. I just don't understand. And he said, we want everyone to look alike. And then I looked at him and I said, well, your head isn't bald. And then he said, drop down and give me another 100 push-ups. Let me tell you, when I got back to my dorm room, I couldn't even lift my arms. So everyone shaved their head. Every last male in the band shaved off everything. All except one person. Guess who that person was?
The band teacher.
I didn't shave my head. So that day forth, I had a target on my back. Everyone hated me. And not only that, they used to hold these secret meetings. And in these meetings, there were things that went on that, let me say, was against school policy. Things that you can get in a lot of trouble for doing. Sometimes they'll put them hands on you. I like to call that hazing. So it got rough. So I decided I'm not going to those meetings. I'm not going to be a part of any of that. So not only was an upperclassman mad, but now my fellow brothers was mad at me that was online with me, because when they went to those meetings, oh, they called a case because somebody didn't show up to those meetings. And because that person didn't show up to those meetings, y'all finna catch a case because of what he is doing. So now they mad at me because they catching a case. So now I'm getting talked about, getting lied on. Soon as I come into the I enter the band room, they got a name for me. There he is, Outcast. There he is. Little smart remarks under their breath, just saying all kind of stuff. And it got to be very discouraging. It got to the point to where I decided, you know what? I don't have to put up with this. So I'm done. I dropped out. I'm through. And then about a month later, something inside of me said, why did you quit? I know it was tough, but why did you quit? So the very next year, 1997, football season, I decided to get back in the band again, give it another shot. But this time, it was much harder than the first time around, because now I'm back again. And the guys that was online with me the first year, all those people had crossed over. And they got beaten black and blue because of what I wasn't willing to do. So now they are over me. Oh, they love that. Oh, they love that. They love that they was over me. So they wanted to make my life a living nightmare. They continued to call me everything but a child of God. But what did I do? I continued to do what I was supposed to do. Show up on practice on time, learn all of the music. And then when I say music, it was a whole lot of music. You had to memorize 75 pieces of music within 2 weeks before that first football game. Can't mess up. You mess up, you lose your position on the field.
That's right.
It was tough. I got through it. Made sure I knew the dance routines. Made sure I never missed a performance. And I did that all the way up to the last football game. Being talked about, lied on, put down, called everything but the child of God. And I got to the last football game, and fortunately, I crossed over and became a member of Alabama State University Mighty Marching Hornets.
Yeah.
About a month after I crossed over, one of my brothers came to me and he said, "You know what? I wish I would have did what you did. Because what we went through, it wasn't worth it. Going to those meetings, them making us do all of that stuff, it wasn't worth it. But what I want to know is how in the world were you able to endure all of that drama, all of that heartache? How did you have the strength to get through that mess for all of those months?" And I said, "I can do all things through Christ with strength." Young people who are in school, when you get talked about, let your light shine.
Yeah. Yeah.
When you get lied on, let your light shine.
Yeah. That's right.
When people try to pressure you to do things that are against the will of God, let your light shine.
Yeah. Yeah.
When people consider you to be an outcast, let your light shine.
Yes.
When you graduate from high school and go off to college, let your light shine.
Yes. Yeah.
When you feel like you're being treated unfairly, let your light shine.
Yeah.
When you graduate from college and you're trying to find a job and no one is opening the door, let your light shine.
Yeah.
When you land a job and the people you work with are not treating you right, let your light shine.
Yeah.
When you get passed up for promotion because they don't like you for whatever reason, let your light shine.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ walked the face of this earth for 33 years and he let his light shine.
Yes.
Jesus was talked about and he let his light shine.
Yes.
Jesus was put down and he let his light shine.
Yes.
Jesus was betrayed and he let his light shine.
Yes.
Jesus was brutal.